and I'd like to welcome you to the Burlington United Church of Christ Congregational for the service of remembrance and celebration for the life of Roland Damiano. Although our hearts are heavy on this day as we prepare to say our final goodbyes to Roland, may they also be filled with gratitude for his life and for the moments that each of you shared with him. My friends, we gather here in the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, release our anger, face our emptiness, and know that God cares. We gather here as God's people, conscious of others who have died and of the frailty of our own existence here on earth. We come to comfort and support one another in our common loss. We gather to hear God's word of hope that can drive away our despair and move us to offer God our praise. We gather to commend to God with thanksgiving the life of Roland Damiano, whose spirit has been liberated from this earthly plane, having been called home into the eternal love from which he was created. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, fountain of all mercy and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with all who mourn, that casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Amen. And now let us rise and sing together, "In the Bulb There Is a Flower," hymn number 433 in your hymn book.
All things, endures all things. never end, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love remain. These three, and the greatest of these is love.
Thank you, Ian. I'd like to invite Ellie Damiani to share a reading from the Gospel according to John.
Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you myself, so that where I am, there you may be also.
Thank you, Ellie. And now I'd like to invite Michael Damiani to share some words about his father.
Thank you all so much for coming today. I'm sure my dad would be concerned about where everyone parked. They got here, what directions. There's this website called The Art of Manliness, which fancies itself as a site about how to be a man. It has articles about things like how to start a fire in the wilderness without matches, and what to wear to a dinner party, how to shuffle poker chips. It has some interesting stuff on there, but I don't think there's a website or a handbook or a cheat sheet that could teach you how to be a man. Only a father can do that. And we were blessed to have a dad that I like to think did that for us. He showed us what it takes to be responsible, how to work hard, to love and raise a family, to laugh, to be practical, to care about those less fortunate than we are, how to throw a baseball and serve a tennis ball, and to pronate the wrist. To play the guy with the puck but anticipate the pass when I played goalie in hockey, even though he never once put on a pair of ice skates. The correct pronunciation of the word forte, which is what he thought fort, which is how the French say it, but he couldn't speak any French. To always floss, to listen, to encourage and support your children, not only in sports, but in whatever endeavors they choose. To not expect too much from your teams. He was a sports encyclopedia, but a sports pessimist, especially with the Patriots and Red Sox, despite the 6 Super Bowls and 4 World Series they gave him over the last 20 years. He and Bill Belichick had a love-hate relationship. My grandfather, like many immigrants in Beverly, worked his whole career at United Shoe, a factory that made the machines that made shoes. And in his spare time, he would help the other Italian immigrants with their immigration papers and help them get jobs. He taught my dad, if not with words, with actions, the value of humility and respect, and compassion and hard work. And he passed that on to us. I remember he once told me he had about 342 sick days saved up at school. He never used them. You rarely called in sick, and when we were kids, you had to be really, really ill to call in to stay home from school. We put education at the top of the list of priorities, as it should be. After serving 2 years in the Navy, he was living with his parents, teaching school in Lexington, where he met my mom. He was 30 at the time, and they dated for about 4 months. Then, like every romantic, he was head over heels for a woman, and knows they found the person they want to spend the next 59 years with. He proposed. Clearly, after endless rewrites and preparation, by asking my mom, "So you want to get married? What?" He taught us that there didn't have to be drama in life, that if you treated people with respect, you would get that in return. But if someone crossed him, watch out. But his revenge was of a special kind, one that only Rolly Damiani could exact or concoct. One time he was getting a newspaper at the convenience store on Wynn Street, and he happened to be cut off by another older gentleman, and they exchanged words out the window and probably hand gestures. And this happened again, at least one other time, same guy. My dad couldn't get over the nerve of this guy. So of course he did what anyone would do. He followed him home one day. He got the man's address. Then he went to the library. He tore up dozens of magazine subscription cards. He signed the man up for countless magazines that would soon flood his mailbox. Surely that will teach him not to mess with Rolly Damiani. When we were very young, we did whatever he had to do to support his family, teaching school during the day and coaching either basketball or football when he wasn't. And when he wasn't coaching, he used to evenings teaching at Middlesex Community College. He taught math for 35 years in Lexington. And in order to challenge himself and so he wouldn't get bored with it, he taught AP Calculus. In order to knowing that the smartest kids would challenge him as much or more than he could challenge himself. He used to sit in the pews that you're sitting in right now, and much to my mom's chagrin, on the back of the church bulletin, scribble out math problems. She would pretend not to notice. He taught computer classes as well, long before the Apple Macintosh existed, on a giant one-piece machine called the PET, the Personal Electronic Transactor, first made in 1977. What seemed like a monstrous piece of machinery, he would haul it into the trunk of our Plymouth Duster and take it home on weekends so my brother and sister and I could play Pong or Space Invaders in our basement on University Avenue. We thought it was the coolest thing ever. Dad was not a traveler, but we still took road trips to Lake Winnipesaukee or Cape Cod for a week-long rental. Somehow my mother convinced him in 1978 that it would be a great idea to go to Florida, to Disney World, in Orlando. So we drove to Orlando in July. We stopped about halfway in Virginia at my mom's parents and swapped cars, borrowing my granddad's Buick Space Station Wagon, an exact replica of the Griswold Stanley Truckster, and drove it the rest of the way. It must have been a horrible drive for them. Three kids in the back for 20 plus hours in the heat. All I remember is a great trip to Disney World. We stayed at Fort Wilderness, the Disney World campground. Five of us crammed into a rented trailer for several days. I don't remember any complaints from my dad. He even rode the teacups ride with me and got so dizzy it ruined the rest of the day for him. But he never said a word about it. We were members of the Burlington Swimming Tennis Club, where my dad took up tennis in his late 40s. Once he started playing, he was hooked. I would go to Wildwood School with him and ride my bike around while he hit balls endlessly against the brick wall. Determined to get better, determined to beat Bill Mullins, who we battled with in the summers, or Ed Good, who we played with at 6 a.m. on weekdays before school started at the Lexington Fieldhouse. He was known for switching hands with his racket. So, when he was pulled out wide on his backhand side, he put the racket in his left hand in order to get the ball back in play. It drove his opponents crazy. "I'd give my left hand to be ambidextrous," was one of his jokes, often confusing the person he was talking to. If you lose your left hand, you can't be ambidextrous. He used the Prince Magnesium Pro. The head was 125 square inches. It's about this big. It was a largest size you could buy. It only made sense to him to have the largest area possible with which to hit the ball. He was a math teacher, after all. He loved telling a good joke. Many of you here have been present for, or the victim of, one of his many roasts, where he was asked to say a few words at a birthday party or any gathering, really, often weaving people in attendance into every joke. He went on for so long at my wedding rehearsal dinner that there was no time for any other toasts or speeches. But it was okay, it was hilarious. Nobody complained, except maybe my wife Hannah, whose entire guest list could not make any speeches because we'd run out of time at the restaurant. My friend Charlie videotaped it. You can hear him laughing throughout the whole thing, trying to keep the camera still. Later on, when my mom had a second career in financial planning, he reluctantly would travel with her to annual conferences in a different city each year and would fly up to California to visit me and my family. Even though he hated flying, gripping the armrest of the entire flight, my mom even convinced him to go on a trip to France with their incredible group of Burlington friends. And finally, a trip to Italy for the two of them, where his parents came from. She's pretty sure he enjoyed it, but we're not sure. But anyways, I moved to California after college in 1995. What are you gonna do out there, huh? Where are you gonna live? I know he didn't get why I would move so far away, but he never once asked me how long I was gonna stay or if or when I was gonna move back. That was 28 years ago. He was proud of us and whatever we did, and we knew it. The last 9 months had to be hard for him, as he was in bed pretty much the whole time. His legs were weak and his body failing. But he took it like a man, he never complained. He was thankful for the care that my mom and his caregiver, Gertruda, gave him. He watched the news and shows with my mom, did crosswords with my sister, and watched baseball and football with my brother and me when I could come back for a visit, which wasn't often enough. I hope I can pass on all that I learned from him to my children and be as good of a man, a father, and a husband as he was to us. Last Thursday, after 24 years, 11 AFC championships, 6 Super Bowls, Bill Belichick left the Patriots. He was a great coach. Also last Thursday, after 90 years, 7 grandchildren, 3 children, and 1 amazing lifelong wife and partner, Earl Damiani left us. He was a great man. I love you, Dad. You will always be in our hearts, and I will always miss you. May you rest in peace.
Second. I don't want to follow that. I should have read your speech first. Jeez, you know, I choked up before I even started. Just want to say thank you all first so much for coming today. Coming out of a cold winter day in the middle of a work week. We really all do appreciate it so much. Extra thanks to all those who had traveled at great expense, like my Aunt Lynn and Wally, Uncle Wally from Virginia, and my brother Mike's entire family who came all the way from California, as well as all the Bucos from up in the North Shore. My dad would have been very honored and touched by how many loving family members, good friends and acquaintances are came to pay their respects today and at the funeral home yesterday. as you probably read in his obituary, my dad, Roly Damiani, was many things to many people. A devoted and loving son to his mother, Barbara Nani Damiani, and brother to Janice Cuco, husband to his wife and my mother, Lucy, a wonderful role model and father to myself, my sister Susan, and my brother Mike, and a well-respected teacher to thousands of students at Lexington High School, Fisher Junior College, and Middlesex Community College. I'd like to add some personal thoughts and memories, though, and I'll try not to go on too long, but as you can imagine, it's hard to keep it short. when you're talking about someone you love and respect so much. So much that I must say, and so many stories I'd like to tell. My goal is just for those who didn't know him well at all, or not very well, to get them to get to know him a little bit, and also for those who love him and did know him well to share some memories and hopefully make you smile. I think my dad would have wanted it that way. Some of you may have noticed the poster of comments if you attended the funeral, last night, of comments and sayings that were posted there, Rollyisms as we call them. My family and I put that together about 5 years ago as a gift for his 85th birthday. They probably made no sense to most of you, but they describe my dad's character, his mannerisms, and his sense of humor on a personal level. And they hang on the wall in the kitchen of my mother's house. So I'd like to give a background on some of those and share some of my own funny memories of him. As Michael mentioned, my dad loved sports. He was always our biggest fan when we played sports growing up. And he would always say, "I'm not just a fan, I'm an athletic supporter." When I played Little League Baseball, he encouraged me to be a pitcher. And he would always push me to practice with him in the backyard. He played catcher for me, even though he never played the position himself. When he played baseball as a young man, he had a proper catcher's mitt, but on more than one occasion, when I would throw a wild pitch in front of him, it became obvious that he wasn't wearing the aforementioned athletic supporter to protect himself. But he came home from work every day and would ask me if I wanted to get back out there again and throw. He loved baseball and wanted me to love it too, and he'd do whatever it took to help me improve. However, side note, he could be pretty stubborn and never did wear any protection at all. So for years, all the way up until the last months of his life, whenever I would talk about working with a power saw, a nail gun, or fishing something out of the disposal, he would say, "Hey, don't use your pitching hand." He did this many, many years after I stopped playing baseball. But that always made me smile, and always will. Once, another anecdote, when I was about 13 or 14 years old, there was a really large beehive near the roof of our house. My dad didn't like heights or climbing ladders, so he said, "Okay, you go up the ladder, spray insecticide into the beehive. If the bees come out and attack you, you just jump and I'll catch you." Yeah, let that sink in. Again, I was about 14 at the time. And as you can imagine, yes, the bees were not happy. They did attack me. I did jump, and no, not surprisingly, he did not catch me. That was the first of several bee-related incidents that I think explain why to this day I still run like my hair is on fire when one flies within 10 feet of me. But back to my dad. Something I came to realize at a pretty young age was that he wasn't afraid of anything, including death. But more about that in a minute. I have a vivid memory of something that happened when I was about 8 years old. Dad used to smoke cigars, and most evenings after dinner he'd smoke one while walking in the yard or watering the grass. There was a black souped-up hot rod car with a loud exhaust that had been speeding down our road recently. And one day when we were out there, we heard it coming. We had a gravel driveway at our old house on University Ave, and just before it got to our house, my dad casually reached down with one hand, scooped up a big handful of rocks, then reared back and threw them, perfectly timed it so they came showering down all over the car as it drove by. Yeah. The driver slammed on the brakes, backed up to our driveway, and stopped. Then a pretty big guy, as I remember, stepped out and looked over the roof at the car at us. The guy was young, probably only a few years out of high school, and he looked pretty tough. I'm not sure how big he was, but he was definitely bigger than my dad. It was maybe 5'8", 160 pounds at the time. And I don't remember exactly what was said, but it's along the lines of the guy yelling, "Hey, what the heck?" Different language, probably, but at my dad. And then my dad calmly saying something like, "You need to slow down. And you got a problem?" And just continue to stand there and smoke a cigar. Like nothing. The guy stared at him for what seemed like a long time, and then he just got back in the car and drove away, more slowly this time. I was absolutely stunned. To me, a young boy who was very into comic books at the time, what had just happened was like finding out that superheroes are real, and my dad is Batman. And by the way, I watched that car and never saw it come down the road again. All right, so my dad had many wonderful qualities, as Michael was saying, but he was not always the most patient or easygoing guy. He could get frustrated and a bit annoyed pretty quickly. And I'm sure my wife and those who know me well are nudging each other and say, "Well, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, does it?" But talk about my dad. So. Anyway, I remember my dad would always yell during snowstorms when he'd see plow trucks going down the road with their plows up. "What are they doing? Why don't they put them down? Jeez, idiots!" when he was frustrated with me and Susan, I'm like, he'd say, ah, come on, come on, come on, this, come on, come on, come on, very quickly. So what are you doing? And maybe throw in a funny, kind of funny insult, which was a play on our last inning by saying, oh, you donkey, Ani. Just for good measure. Another thing about him, although he was smart and a pretty good athlete, he was not very good with his hands and had a hard time fixing anything around the house. I remember many times when he was trying to put on a car wiper blade or a grill or a piece of furniture together, my mother would hear him loudly cursing and say to me, will you please go help your father before he has a stroke? Our family's favorite Christmas movie is probably A Christmas Story, you know, the one with Ralphie and the official Red Ryder carbine action 200 sharp range model air rifle with a compass in stock and this thing that tells time? That's the one. Well, the line from that movie that always reminds us of and perfectly describes old Rolly is, my father worked in profanity the way that other artists might work in oils or clay. It was his true medium, a master. I'd love to share some examples of the verbal volcano that would erupt during those moments with you all, but since we're in a church, and a church that my mother loves so much, if you're curious, just follow up with me after the service. Compare notes. The two things that I think I admired most, impressed me most about my dad were his intelligence and his sense of humor. His knowledge and ability to communicate the most difficult advanced mathematical problems, concepts, even many years after he retired from teaching, was incredible. In his memory, the way he could recall statistics about specific baseball or football players and scores from games that were played 40 to 50 years ago never ceased to amaze me. And although his career and academic degrees were in mathematics, he really loved the English language. He had an impressive vocabulary and used to correct people when he heard them make grammatical mistakes. It especially annoyed him when it was a sportscaster or someone on the news whose job it was to communicate verbally. He'd say, irregardless isn't a word. It's he and I went to the game, not him and me, because they are used as a subject of sentence. And it's not I feel badly for him, it's I feel bad for him because the linking verb feels the adjective back to the subject I. I didn't say that fast, I know. It's hard to follow. And it was always funny when he did that, although not quite as much when he was correcting you. Anyway, I think that his appreciation for the language influenced my decision to major in English in college, and that's probably why I speak it so good today. Okay, all right. I was going to say, those of you didn't get that, including your service. All right, now as for his sense of humor, that was the other thing. Here we go. As many of you know, and as Michael mentioned, he had a great sense of humor and loved stand-up comedy, and this is something that I came to appreciate through him, I think. My two boys also really enjoyed as well. He loved being the MC, the master of ceremonies, roasting family and friends at a wedding, retirement party, or a group of strangers even. And he'd get up at a moment's notice to tell jokes for easy 30 to 45 minutes without looking at any notes. He didn't write his own material, but as he used to say, I plagiarize only from the best. He loved Rodney Dangerfield, I think, the most, and his one-liners. He often leveraged those for his material, like those about marriage. I haven't spoken to my wife in years. I didn't want to interrupt her. My wife, I get no respect. I fell asleep with a cigarette in my hand. She lit it. I told my wife the truth, that I was seeing a psychiatrist. Then she told me the truth. She was seeing two plumbers, a doctor and a bartender. My wife and I were happy for 20 years. Then we met. He did about 45 minutes at his 50th anniversary party, and he told this going. My wife and Lucy, we actually met on a blind date. I walked to her, up to her where we agreed to meet, and I said, hi, are you Lucy? She said, are you rolling? I said, yes. And she said, then I'm not Lucy. Another one of his running gags, he would always introduce my mom to people by saying, this is my first wife, Lucy. So all of you married men out there, it would be a nice tribute to him if you all did that going forward. And ladies, there's a comeback to that line, but please see me after the service. He also liked that self-deprecating humor and jokes. When I was a kid, my family moved around a lot, but I always found them. I can tell my parents hated me. My bath toys were a toaster and a radio. I was so ugly, I told my doctor I wanted a vasectomy. He said, with a face like yours, you don't need one. I had terrible acne as a kid. One time I fell asleep in the library, and when I woke up, a blind kid was reading my face. He wasn't a religious man, and he liked to tell jokes poking fun at God and church and afterlife and religion in general. But out of my respect for mom, and out of fear that I'll be hit by lightning or spontaneously combust up here, I'll tell one of the very few that he really liked and that I think or hope he's clinging to tell. A guy who didn't believe in God or an afterlife dies and finds himself in heaven at the pearly gates. Stunned and a little embarrassed, he meets St. Peter, a little sheepishly, he says, hey, I wasn't so bad, right? I mean, How many times did I take the Lord's name in vain? 1,000,006? Jesus Christ. Yeah, I didn't see any of that. He really likes it. The man upstairs didn't like it. I'm sure he's getting an earful about it right now. I'll probably get an earful about it too. So my dad's own sense of humor and courage over the last 9 months or so, especially, I think that's what I remember most. Even though he didn't have much time left with us, and at times he struggled to speak loud enough for us to hear, he still managed to make us laugh. Just a few weeks ago when I visited him, I picked up the paper. He said, "You know, now that I'm old, I read the obituaries out in the paper every day. I think it's strange how people always die in alphabetical order." And though it was an uncomfortable topic, he wanted to discuss plans for his funeral and the arrangements with us. During one of those solemn conversations, he suddenly said, "I want my headstone to say, 'See, I told you I was sick.'" Just over a month ago at Thanksgiving dinner, my mother had us all hold hands and say a prayer before we began to eat, as we always do. My dad, who was not a very religious guy, to say the least, and used to argue with my mom about whether it was pronounced Amen or Amen, interrupted my mother right before she had finished the prayer and said loudly, "Amen." Finally, as you know, it was his wish to be cremated. And when we asked where he wanted us to spread his ashes, he said, "Surprise me." Kept his sense of humor right up into the very end. Where's the rest of it? Okay. So I hope that those of you who didn't know him well know him a little better. And if you laugh even a little at my tribute, I'm sure my dad's very happy right now. So I'll just close by saying my dad was an enormous influence on me. I truly love spending time with and talking to him, and I'll forever be grateful to have had him as a father. I really couldn't have asked for better, and I can't imagine what I did in a previous life to deserve him. If I'm a good son to my mother, husband to my wife, father to my children, sibling to Mike and Sue, and a good friend to all my buddies, it's all because of him. And to you, Rolly, Papa, Nono, Dad, I am of course saddened by now to now be facing the stark reality that you are physically no longer with us, but I feel that I am, in a very real sense, just an extension of and part of you. I know that you will live on in our memories and that we will all be together again someday. I love you so much, Dad, and thank you for being an incredible father and my very best friend. Until we meet again, may you finally and forever rest in peace.
Now, Susan, Stephen, and Michael will share a song.
Oh, in the handout, what do you call that thing? It has the chorus to the song. If you guys hear a new tune, appreciate you guys wanting to join in and sing this chorus with us. I'm going to serve with the unbroken heart. By and by, Lord. This is our first church team.
Sure, you want to come up with those facts? No?
Now you're good.
Thank you.
Amen. For the entire time that I had the opportunity to know Rolly, he was confined to a bed. At the end of his life, his body began to fail him, as happens to all of us, if we're fortunate enough to live as many years as Rolly lived. Even as his body slowed down, the strength of his spirit remained. When we prayed together, I felt that the light inside him still burned bright. And when members of our church visited to sing Christmas carols, Rolly glowed with appreciation and recognition. Love overflowed, and his spirit stood and sang even when his body could not. Now, Rolly's spirit has been set free, liberated from this earthly plane, from a body that could no longer contain the fullness of his spirit. So while we all feel sadness and grief over Rolly's death, may we also feel gratitude for his life, for all the times that we shared with him, for all the many ways that he blessed the lives of those who knew him and loved him, and for the release of his spirit, welcomed finally into his heavenly home. The promise of our faith tells us that death is not the end, but a new birth into eternal life in the Spirit of God, the Spirit that first created us, the Spirit that created Rolly, that held him in love and inspired him to love his whole life long. And we just heard Stephen and Michael talk about Rolly's sense of humor, his joy for life. He had a curiosity about the world, a desire to learn new things, a sense of never settling, never being finished, always inspired, always exploring. Rolly was a seeker, looking to discover more and more about what makes our world interesting and beautiful. Rolly recognized that life is the continuous unfolding of opportunities, not threats or dangers or obstacles, but opportunities. Opportunities for connection, for laughter, for learning, for teaching, for music, for feasting, for hoping, for dreaming. Each moment a gift, an open-ended blessing with which to build a life, a home, a family, brick by brick, moment by moment. All people, humans, mortals, have a tendency to think that death creates an abrupt end to this string of unfolding moments. From our very limited perspective, it seems as if Rolly's opportunities to learn and grow and laugh have ended. And similarly, our opportunities to learn from him, laugh with him, and love him are gone. But in faith, I tell you this isn't so. And you will come to see in the coming days, weeks, and months, if you haven't already. Our scripture promises that love never ends. Rolly's spirit is not gone. And sometime soon, perhaps today, you will find yourselves laughing with him once again, learning from him. You'll find yourself feeling loved by him, because love never ends. The curious, generous, open-hearted love that Rolly shared throughout his life is the love that God invites us into through Jesus Christ. This is the love that invites us into eternal life, the love that reveals the kingdom of heaven, the love that cannot be extinguished, not even through death. Now God has provided him with new life, free from pain, free from suffering, welcomed back into the eternal loving arms that first created him, that loved him and held him every day of his life. Sickness and sorrow are lifted. He is free once again to live fully, deeply, joyfully, generously. In faith, we trust that his light shines still in the hearts of all those who knew and loved him, and that his life continues to be an inspiration to all of us to love the world the way God loves the world. Let us pray. O holy God, we pray that you bless your children gathered here this day. Be with them in their grief and in their sadness. We know that a broken heart cannot be mended to its original state, but we pray that you open the hearts of your beloved gathered here to feel your light breaking through. May they be surrounded and comforted by the love and light that Rolly shared during his life, and may we all give thanks for the blessings of his life. O God, our strength and our Redeemer, Giver of life and conqueror of death, we praise you with humble hearts. With faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust Rolly Damiani to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for him all the days of his earthly life. We thank you for all that he was to those who loved him. And we thank you that for Rolly all sickness and sorrow are ended, and death itself is past, that he has entered the home where all your people gather in peace. Keep us all in communion with your faithful people in every time and place, that at last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Hear our prayer as we say together the words that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us stand and let our voices rise together as we sing, Morning Has Broken, which you will find in your bulletin. Lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in peace this day, and may the light of Rolly's life and laughter and joy shine upon all of you. Go in peace. Amen. Please be seated as Stephen and Michael will close us with a song.
Song before I start. I'll be right back just in case I screwed up or get choked up. This song is by a guy named Warren Zevon. Some of you may have heard of him. He's known for songs like Lawyers, Guns, and Money and Werewolves of London. And this song is on his final album, which he began recording shortly after he was diagnosed with inoperable mesothelioma, which, as some of you may know, is a type of lung cancer. So, like my dad, these last few months, he knew he didn't have much time left. And the album, which was called The Wind, was released only 2 weeks before he died. And Keeping Your In Your Heart is the very last song on the album. It's sort of his goodbye to all of his friends and loved ones. And the lyrics and the idea of the song is what I alluded to earlier, that a person continues to exist in a very real sense, as long as the ones that they leave behind still remember them. So I'd like to dedicate and sing this song to the love of my dad's life and his partner of nearly 60 years, my mom, who's hearing the song for the first time.
Shadows are falling and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while. If I leave you, it doesn't mean I love you any less.
us conclude our service today. Thank you for being here, and we hope to see you at the reception later on. Keep early in your heart for a while.